operator shall exercise editorial control of a public use of channel. Minor said that he thought it was a limited forum. Van Grafelin thought that the place would fill up on a first-come, first-served business basis. Rather, I have been in cable television for 23 years, and that has never happened. It's never even come close to happening. Van Grafelin is from Rochester, up around there, and public access up around Rochester isn't what it is here in New York City, the New York metropolitan market. You have McLaughlin not saying much. You have Mark Fowler making misrepresentations to the court. That's what lawyers get paid for, particularly sadly Stevens, Burke, and Burke. Again, I tell you, Mark Fowler was a former chairman of the FCC. And then you have Glendora saying at the end that Mark Fowler broke the law again right there in front of all three judges by saying that Glendora didn't have a right to talk about personal disputes on television. And Glendora making the point that the O.J. Simpson trial is all about personal disputes. Court TV is always about personal disputes. So there's not much profundity to that argument. So now where do we stand? We're waiting for Judge Bryant. This panel that you just heard vacated Judge Bryant's decision. I wish they had reversed it and remanded it to White Plains, and that's where it is right now. And where does it stand? Judge Bryant said Cablevision again fled from discovery, fugitives of discovery, just as they did in state court. So I made a motion to Judge Bryant to compel discovery. And Judge Bryant disappointed me. Instead of following the laws, Federal Rules of Civil Procedure, Rules 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, Judge Bryant let him get away with it. And he called a conference for July the 28th, that's a week from this coming Friday, to listen to Cablevision why they shouldn't be compelled to do the discovery. I can't see that argument. That's the law. Discovery is the law. Duty to disclose, Rule 26 says. Duty to disclose. And of course, Cablevision doesn't want to disclose, because they know they've done wrong all the way through. But it is their duty to disclose. That's what discovery is all about, folks. It's all about getting the truth out in front, bringing out the truth exactly how things happen, the precise chronology as to how things happen. That's the truth. Then a decision can be made. Then and only then. Okay, so I'm sending this tape to Judge Bryant. Seems to me the government should know more about audio recording than that. That's a pretty bad recording. They should have microphones positioned better. They should have better sound equipment to pick them up. Seems like the United States government could do better than that. So here is the letter that is going out to Judge Bryant today, July the 19th, 1995, Wednesday. Chambers of the Honorable Charles L. Bryant, United States Courthouse, Southern District of New York, 300 Quaropus Street, White Plains, New York, 10601, regarding Glendora versus Cablevision et al., number 93 Civ, 8344. Dear Judge Bryant, sorry about that. Must be a ponderous letter. Glendora asks you to hear the audio tape of September 20th, 1994, Judges Minor, Van Grafelin, and McLaughlin. Judge Minor's words are very interesting. Manhattan Neighborhood Network Time Warner told Glendora Tuesday that the Alliance for Community Media got a stay pending the outcome of their appeal to the United States Supreme Court. So that stalls the hopes of Kalaji that the District of Columbia Circuit decision speaks for you. That is not an issue anymore. It is not a defense and never was. Glendora would like your permission to videotape for TV her July the 28th hearing in your courtroom. Yours in truth, Glendora. So, we could deliver that personally to Judge Bryant because the United States Courthouse in White Plains is just 3-4 blocks from us. But I don't think that would be fair to Kalaji, whose letter copy is going out, and also to Grayson and to Perry. So I think they all should go out together. My mother taught me, folks, that 10 minutes a day can get a big job done. So I read the Federal Rules of Civil Procedure 10 minutes a day. And I'm reading the Rules of Discovery, and I've learned to say them by heart. Number 26 is the provisions, general provisions governing discovery and duty to disclose. It's a long rule, Rule 26. Rule 27 is discovery before the action begins. Rule 28 is persons before whom discovery may be taken. Rule 29 is depositions upon oral questions. And Rule 30 is depositions upon written questions. And Rule 31 is the use of depositions in court procedure. And Rule 32, I left out one, it's out of place. It's stipulations, I left it out, that's 29. So let's just go on with 33. Is interrogatories, and 34 is discovery, production of documents and things, and on-site inspections, and Rule 35 is mental examinations and physical examinations. And Rule 36 is admissions, as I read you, the admissions of Cablevision. Admit that they broke a state law. Admit that they broke a federal law. Admit that they can't control editorially public access. And then the last rule is very important. It's Rule 37. And what happens when people do not cooperate with discovery and the sanctions, and how you can make a motion to compel discovery. And if the order is given and the parties still refuse to discovery, how they can be sanctioned by the court. All of this discovery is supposed to go on outside of the court. It's not supposed to bear down upon the court. But of course, Cablevision, in its law breaking, see, there's three things that Cablevision does. They break the law, then they lie about it, and they cover up. So there's going to be, this is what I'm going to say on July the 28th. That this is the appropriate court for this motion compelling disclosure, and what the motion is, and that Cablevision failed to make a disclosure required by Federal Rules of Civil Procedure 26A, and they failed to disclose, and they failed to cooperate, and that I am therefore allowed to move to compel discovery with appropriate sanctions, and I'd like to see him get fined $10,000. And that I confer that in good faith that I have tried to do this discovery with these defendants, and the defendants have done nothing, and they should be sanctioned. And I made an effort to secure disclosure without court action, and the defendants failed to answer questions propounded and submitted under Rules 30 and 31. The corporation has failed to make a designation under Rule 30B and 31A, and defendants have failed to answer interrogatories submitted under Rule 33, and defendants have failed under Rule 34 to respond that inspection will be permitted, as requested, and defendants failed to respond when inspection was requested, and therefore plaintiff appellant Glendora Moi moves for an order compelling an answer and a designation and an order compelling inspection in accordance with her request, a request made way back in May of 1995, and Glendora certifies in this affidavit that she sent her 5 discovery demands, 1 each day consecutively, May 30th, May 31st, June 1st, June 2nd, June 3rd. Franklin served them and provided copies to Judge Bryant, Brian Grafman, and Robert Perry. Glendora attempted to confer with these Cablevision defendants in an effort to secure the information without court action, and the sanctions defendants should pay pursuant to Rule 37A4A, the reasonable expenses incurred in making this motion, 3 hours of time and labor at $250 per hour, and by Rule 37B42, if Glendora succeeds in her motion to compel discovery, she pleads that if Cablevision Dolan, Dada, Quinn, Bell et al. Be ordered in contempt of court and be sanctioned $10,000. Glendora's rights were violated enough in the original law breaking. Now her rights to discovery are being violated. Okay. Now we will turn our attention to the logs. What happened from July the 13th to July the 19th. This log, folks, did get out on schedule, which was Monday. And we are doing very well over at TCI, editing with Linda, who we are both learning how to do the work that Superman Frankel does. And we got all of the editing done, and we got it done early, and I must commend Cablevision Yonkers for their very fine coverage of the rally on June the 19th about bad judges in front of the Westchester County Supreme Court. The 13th of July had 70 jobs on it. You can't do 70 jobs in a day. You can maybe do 30 or 40. Thank the town of Plymouth, Joan Heberly, the clerk, for disinterring Franklin's Honorable Army discharge after 5 years in World War II, D-Day and VE Day, Victory in Europe Day, for disinterring that and getting us a copy. So thank you, clerk. 4 tapes were taken to Gary up at Yorktown Cablevision, and 4 tapes were, 3 tapes, VHS, were taken to Cross River, as United Video, North Salem, South Salem, Purdy's, Golden's Bridge, and South Salem, Cross River played the program not only on Friday night, but also on Saturday night and Sunday night, and they play it for 2 hours each night. So no wonder everybody up there sees it. Arnold Edmond did not answer. CBS is selling at $65 a share. Cablevision is selling at $67 a share. I've never seen that. And Texaco is selling at $66, and Gannett is selling at $54. The Center for Judicial Accountability, making judges behave themselves and act the way they should act, is doing a great job. We're going to use a Rolodex for credit and get a new microcassette recorder. That will be my 5th one, audio recorder. I called Americans for Legal Reform, and Susan lost her house, and it's another injustice. And the Nassau County Supreme Court is as bad as the Westchester County Supreme Court. Have a new audio cassette of hymns. You're hearing it now. It's beautiful. It's more on the classical side. It really isn't hymns, it's religious music by Handel and Haydn and Bach. Finished the Cablevision annual report. I'm happy to say it's a hodgepodge. The whole company is a hodgepodge. We're working a lot on the new wall lawsuits. We're working on Cablevision Discovery. Burton Roberts committee report on cameras in the courtroom. Instead of the legislature making it permanent, they have another experiment for 2.5 years, and that's screwy to do such a thing. Today I'm getting my life back. On Saturday the 15th, all of the legal papers were done by something like 10:30. I was able to go out and sit in the woods, and I talked to Cesar, or I listened to him talk for 55 minutes as he told me about his country, Peru, and the interior over the Andes, where the Indians are, and where they have wonderful herb cures, and saved his little brother. His little brother would have died. And Cesar has 15 uncles on his father's side, and then more on his mother's side. He has 24 uncles altogether. And the work was all done, folks. All the work was done by, what hour was that? Oh, 5:28 p.m. And that's 7 days in July that's happened, and that's what I mean by I'm getting my life back. That if your rights are violated, you go to court and you will find justice. Well, that's a lie, or it's ignorance, that it's not so. Your rights are violated and you go to court and you get injustice. And all that court amounts to is greedy, grubby judges looking for political appointments, throwing justice to the winds, not following the law, not ruling by the controlling law. That's what courts are. It's just a pile of rubble. We have no courts. So don't ever believe that if you're wrong, you go to court and you'll find justice. I don't know what century that belonged to, but it certainly doesn't belong to this one. We had to pay for the furnace, $28. The landlord should be paying for the furnace. A landlord who makes $16,000 on these 16 apartments every month should be able to pay for the major capital improvement. I rally 7 different ways. I carry a poster on my back, a poster on my front. I have my videotape camera to report it to you. I have leg pockets that have flyers in it. I take those out and I hand those out to people. I handed out 140 flyers. I also chant, down with Ingracia, down with Nikolai, down with Coppola, down with Colabella, down with Wood, down with Silverman. And then I hand out, I get people to sign the petitions to conduct public hearings on judicial corruption and to have a committee stop the manipulation of judgeships in the state of New York. And I went out and got petitions signed on that, and a man named Ronald Linton joined me. And after that's all done out on the street, the rallying, then we go into the courthouse and we sit down and we watch the judges. And we watched Judge Colabella, and everything was fine for 5 minutes, and all of a sudden Judge Colabella gets up, goes down the stairs, gets off the bench, and leaves the courtroom. What happened? A judge is supposed to say why he's leaving the courtroom. A judge is supposed to say how long he will be gone, and a judge is supposed to say why he's leaving the courtroom. And Judge Silverman did an outrageous thing. We covered the courtrooms on the 16th floor, and then we went to the courtrooms on the 18th floor. Donovan had people standing up in the courtroom, There weren't any chairs, so we didn't stay there. We went on. And we went down to Judge Silverman's courtroom, and I went in, and I sat down in the left corner, and Ronald sat down with me to watch the court, and Judge Silverman said, "You can't sit down in here. This is a closed proceeding." Well, I have a lot to talk to you about that. July 19, 1995, that is today. Two, Donald N. Silverman, Justice so-called, Westchester Supreme Court, from Glendora, quo warranto. Glendora demands that you show her by writ of right, by which you are required to show by what right you exercised any office, any franchise, or any liberty to exclude Glendora from the court proceeding at 11:25 a.m. July 17, 1995, Monday, in courtroom 801 Westchester County Courthouse Tower. At 11:25 a.m., Glendora entered courtroom 801 to monitor the proceeding. She had a witness with her, Ronald Litton. Glendora took a seat in the left corner to monitor. Donald Silverman said, "You cannot sit down in here. This is a closed proceeding." Glendora and Ronald rose. Glendora took note of every face present in the courtroom, approximately 22 people. Glendora and Ronald, with no words, left the courtroom. Both checked the calendar on the wall outside the courtroom door. Approximately 12 cases were listed. Causes of action were contract, motor, vehicle, and other torts. There was not one case listed that smacked of any such thing as a closed proceeding. Upon information and belief, Glendora states that Judge Silverman fabricated closed proceeding, quote unquote, in a rash of temper, petulance, and hatred. Characteristic of said judge is exhibited in September 1994 in the hall outside of his 18th floor robing room at that time when he screamed at Glendora, see the record, and characteristic of said judge when he cited Glendora for contempt July the 14th, 1994. Glendora exposed both of these outbursts. There was no court officer at the door of courtroom 801, inside or out, on July 17, 1995 to say this is a closed proceeding. Glendora believes this was an ad libitum statement made in blind rage. She will return with witnesses to courtroom 801 and monitor. Even Judge Colabella said to Glendora, "You have every right to be in this courtroom." Judge Donald N. Silverman violated the Sixth Amendment of the Constitution of the United States, which he took an oath to support. The accused has a right to a public trial. A trial is not public if the public is excluded, which Judge Silverman did Monday, July the 17th at 11:25 a.m. Glendora is outraged by instances in which Judge Silverman, who should know better, has broken laws. She exposed his record, gagging Glendora's free speech with a hasty signing of an order to show cause, robbing Glendora of her costs twice, signing an order 2 weeks late after it has expired, never giving any law or fact as basis for signing these three rob orders. What is his motive? Plain, juvenile, uncontrollable rage and hate. How does this fit in with 22 NYRR, the Judicial Code of Conduct? These are the things that judges are supposed to be. These are the things you never see judges be. This is a shameful record to leave your progeny. Other laws broken by Donald Silverman, signing a TRO of a plaintiff when the Article 60 law applies to defendants, not plaintiffs. Amendment, rescission, or adoption of rules. It says in the CPLR that no rule so amended, rescinded, or adopted shall abridge or enlarge the substantive rights of any party, and no judge shall abridge the substantive rights of any party, Glendora says. And we have construction that the civil practice law and rule shall be liberally construed to secure the just, speedy, and inexpensive determination of every civil judicial proceeding. Where and when have you seen that in the Westchester Supreme Court? Glendora received no damages. Glendora received no costs. Her causes of action were not granted. The consolidation statute should be liberally construed to secure the just, speedy, and inexpensive termination of the proceeding. Glendora says, "I shall return yours in truth, Glendora, to Judge Kay, Judge Trafficante, Judge Malonis, and Judge Ingracia." and hear some jokes for you. The popularity of antiques is really something. Right now there are 25 million Americans who have things that are old, funny looking, don't work, and are kept around for sentimental purposes. Some of them are called antiques and some of them are called husbands. And folks, if you look like your passport photo, you're too sick to travel. And Betty and her husband are celebrating their 10 anniversary. That's their 7th anniversary. Their 10th anniversary. And that's 7 years of eating out of cans. And now we have for you a letter to the chambers of the Honorable Charles L. Bryant, United States District Court, Southern District of New York, 300 Quaropa Street, White Plains, New York, 10601. You remember when they used to be on Post Road? I've heard of moving the court, right? But this is ridiculous. Regarding Glendora versus Cablevision et al., number 93, Civ 8344, dear Judge Bryant, Glendora is disappointed you did not compel Cablevision lawbreakers to keep the record to discover schedule as written out twice. Glendora is entitled to discovery. She's been reading and reading the discovery rules, 26 to 39, Federal Rules of Civil Procedure. She knows them by heart. She has read them 7 times at least and is still going. Everything in there says Glendora is entitled to discovery. It is not fair that you have let Cablevision lawbreakers be fugitives of discovery again, nor is it legal. All they write is a flimsy letter, not even a motion to stay, and you let them get away with that and miss the discovery schedule a second time. Glendora loves going to your courtroom and always has and goes when she doesn't even have to, just to watch the fascinating and significant things that happen there, but she's disappointed you called a conference instead of compelled discovery. Time's a-wasting. Professor Perry is right, naturally, about Kalaji in reality asking for a summary judgment. Yet over in state court, he is basing his whole appeal on Judge Silverman's wrongly converting Glendora's motion to dismiss his motion to dismiss into summary judgment. In federal court, he is dodging the converse. 2 cars collided, a 3rd car pulled up, a man got out. He said, I saw the whole thing happen. I'm a lawyer. I'll take either side. Tony Bravado referred to Kalaji's limp letter as a motion to stay. Glendora took exception. Tony corrected it on July 11, 3:40 p.m. when she telephoned to set up the July 28th conference. Discovery is a law, and the law is not being kept here. How can Cablevision lawbreakers complain that Glendora failed to add as defendant any county official before Glendora can have discovery to find out which county officials exerted pressure on Glendora, on Cablevision rather, to censor her program and violate a state law and a federal law? This is what Professor Perry said to you. Glendora needs of the lawbreakers oral deposition, interrogatories, production of documents and things, on-premises inspection, and admissions. Glendora's asked for all of these twice, and nothing happens. Rule 26 emphatically says, duty to disclose. The Second Circuit had in mind getting this case resolved quickly and finally. This delay on discovery should never have been allowed. When can I start discovery? Glendora asked Judge Bryant March 3, 1995, if she stood all alone before him, only with Franklin, no defendants present, and no amici. As soon as you file your amended complaint, and the sooner the better, Judge Bryant said. Glendora filed her amended complaint March 20, 1995, and Cablevision has not complied with one bit of discovery. This is not right. Glendora takes exception to the discovery procrastination. This whole case is taking too long. From November 12, 1993 to July 15, 1995 is a year and 9 months. Glendora has already carried these lawbreakers longer than their mothers did. When Glendora saw the $33 million courthouse go up, she said to everybody, I hope we get $33 million worth of justice out of it. Questions. Glendora has not heard anything since March 24, 1995 about the damages to which Judge Bryant said she was entitled. All people involved should reread the minutes of March the 3rd, 1995, and March the 24th of 1995. Amicus Curiae, Grafman sent Glendora a copy of the audio tape before Judges Minor, Van Greifelen, and McLaughlin, September the 20th, 1993, when Judge Minor told Mark Fowler, former chairman of the FCC, "You don't know much about this, but Congress and its and the state legislature know a lot about it." Minor. "And they say everybody, and they say to let everybody in there, and they mean public access, access by the whole public without any censorship. Again, what is taking so long? They broke a law, they admit it." And regardez, s'il vous plaît, Professor Perry's third point, ecology, cable vision, is not confined their analysis to what Glendora alleges in her second amended complaint. They keep making up new reasons, and that is not to be allowed. Summary judgment, the Second Circuit has said over and over, is inappropriate. The last time they said it was January 11th on vacate and remand. A once interesting case, and as Judge Bryant said twice, March 3rd, 1995, a case of nationwide significance, is getting dull as dishwater, is getting dull as dishwater. Let's move. This delay is not fair and is not reasonable. Judge Bryant told Glendora March 3rd, 1995, to read Federal Rules of Civil Procedure Rule 8. She has read it along with Rules 1 to 25 30 times. She can list them by heart and does so on her TV show. What else can she do while she is in boredom, awaiting the discovery to which she is entitled and which is the law? Glendora looks forward to the July 28th conference, and there's the Blue Jay protesting it. In Judge Bryant's richly red, wall-to-wall carpeted courtroom, the only one with an arched window back-to-back to the bench, but she looks forward to discovery and moving this case onward more. Did the court hear Glendora's TV joke? She has told of moving the court, but this is ridiculous. The old Post Road courthouse was more fun. You could see people instead of talking to them through an intercom. You people are getting too big for your pants over there with your new $31 million courthouse, $33 million. You are losing contact with the people who bought it for you. Yours in truth, Glendora, Tukalaji, Perry, and Grafman. The last matter on cablevision is the sheriff's complaint number 5, the sheriff of Westchester County. Colonari, County Executive Andrew O'Rourke, County Attorney Assistant Robert Villani, Sheriff's Office Bill Ryan, Officer Richard Johnson, Sheriff's Office, same office, James Eakley, who never collects in Port Chester, Glendora's TV audience, JSC Donald N. Silverman, and to anybody else of interest. Here's what sheriffs are supposed to do. Yours in truth, Glendora, and it should have been signed. And what I've copied here, you know, the New York statutes is about 130 volumes, books, because the volumes are numbered differently. Like there's volume 4, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and so that comes out to about 10 books. Anyhow, one of those statutes is county law. And so I looked up the county law, and I looked up what the sheriff is supposed to do. And so I sent this to them and told them this is what sheriffs are supposed to do, since they never do any of these things. Very brief law. Sheriffs are supposed to go out and collect judgments, and not for undisclosed reasons, and leaving reasons wildly to your imagination, not collect the judgments. I had a judgment against Cablevision, and they were supposed to go out and collect it. But in cahoots with the county attorney, the sheriff's office in cahoots with the county attorney, and also with Judge Silverman, I think there was collusion on the part of all three parties, failed to collect my costs that I am entitled to. On Glendora versus James Kofall, Cablevision, Dolan, Tata, Bell, Quinn, and so forth. Cost of approximately $1,000. And that ends the reports on Cablevision from July the 13th, Thursday, up through today, July the 19th, Wednesday. The reason I have to videotape on Wednesday is that Continental Cable TV is a pain in the neck, requiring a disclaimer and requiring a countdown. You know, Shouldn't be that hard to queue up a program. So because of that, I have to edit on Wednesday in order to get a new program to Continental for Saturday, because I don't allow repeats. No repeats. Every program is new. New neurotic. Tour guide over in Roman Italy said, "This building has been here for over 300 years. Not a stone has been touched. Nothing has changed. Nothing has been replaced." And the tourist said, "They must have the same landlord we do." And the sergeant says, "This bullet will penetrate 2 feet of solid wood. So men, keep your heads down." 2 feet of solid wood. That's Herald wood. And Bob used to shampoo with Head and Shoulders. Now he uses Mop and Glow. Let me give you a summary of Glendora versus Gannett, Mitchell Broder, John Curley, Douglas McCorkindale, Gary Watson, Gary Sherlock, and Kenneth Paulson, Gannett Company Incorporated. It all started with Mitch Broder saying he was going to write a story about Glendora, and Glendora put in 30 hours of hard work and time to give him all of the information he needed. And Mitchell Broder didn't have the discipline nor the maturity to sit down at the typewriter and write the story. And so he whined out of it and said, "I may not write this story." And Glendora was, of course, very upset, having spent all that time and having dealt with him in good faith, and then to have him deal in bad faith. And so Glendora sued him for breach of contract. Judge Johnston in Harrison should have known that it was a breach of contract. But, of course, Judge Johnston is going to rule what is best for Judge Johnston, as all judges do. And so it's better for him to be on the side of Gannett than it is on the side of Glendora. So he copped out to Gannett. Glendora appealed it at the appellate term. And judges in Gracia, Collins, and DiPaolo are going to do what is best for judges and not what is best for justice. And so they affirmed the decision. The greedy, grubby lawyer was Robert Britton. And then the next day, Gannett, typically Gannett, has a story in the paper by Kevin Gray, who is no longer with the paper, we are happy to say. Kevin Gray saying that, quoting a Britton, but not quoting Glendora, and telling a lie that Glendora could not be reached for comment when she was available at all times. It's just an out-and-out lie. And further, it was not a true and fair report of a judicial proceeding. And so Glendora sued him for libel, which they certainly did commit. And the next greedy, grubby lawyer on that was Robert Kalaji of Satterley, Stevens, Burke, and Burke, grasping. And the crooked judge on that was Gordon Burroughs. And the bad law clerk was Charles Devlin. And so naturally, they're going to rule for Gannett. They would rather have Gannett on their side than Glendora on their side. So judges always rule what is best for judges. And that was in 1992. And Gordon Burroughs and Charles Devlin did not have to impose costs, but they chose to do so, saying it is the law when it isn't the law. And so we're having a conspiracy going on here in the Westchester Supreme Court. Costs are imposed upon Glendora, but when Glendora wins, Judge Silverman won't let her collect costs. So we have something going on here. We certainly don't have justice going on. And I say it's the Westchester Supreme Court, but apparently the courts are just as bad in Putnam, from what I hear from people up there, and they're just as bad in Nassau, from what I hear from Americans and for legal reform. And poor Susan, who just lost her house, which wasn't fair. Isn't that awful? And so I took Gordon Burroughs' rotten decision to the appellate division, but the appellate division, second department, is always going to do what is best for judges. They're not going to do anything for justice. And so they rubber stamped Gordon Burroughs And then I took it to the New York State Court of Appeals, and they're not even going to take your case. They won't even listen to you. Such is justice in the state of New York, or lack of justice. And so that's Glendora versus Gannett, all because Mitchell Broder did not have the maturity, nor the upbringing, nor the ethics to do his job and keep his word. And all because Gannett ran away and instead of coming forth and saying, yes, what we did was wrong, we know better, we're sorry, we'll make amends, instead of doing that, they just lied and covered up for 4.5 years and are still doing so. Move on to a quick summary of the bad decisions of Matthew F. Coppola, who is costing the state over $105,000 a year, costing you, and will continue costing $105,000 a year for the next 12 years. We rented a co-op, and the owner of the co-op charged us 3 times the amount of rent that would be allowed. It was under the ETPA, the Emergency Tenant Protection Act, and it was under the Division of Housing and Community Renewal. And he charges 3 times what he should have charged. He never registered the co-op with the DHCR. He broke all kinds of laws. And so I filed my complaint against him, and I was given back $5,300, $5,300. So we won that, but the ETPA has a rule that if the owner doesn't show or cannot prove that this was not a willful overcharge, then he has to pay triple damages. Well, this owner never proved that, yet the DHCR lied about it. And they did not grant the triple damages, and that's the law that they should. And here the DHCR is charged by the people of New York to enforce the Emergency Tenant Protection Act. So that was crooked all the way through. And then the landlord harassed this tenant to move. He harassed, I think, 15 times, 13 times, and the ETPA has a rule that a tenant cannot be harassed to be moved under rent control. And each offense, I think the first offense is $1,500, and each one thereafter is $3,000. It amounted to something like $17,000 in offenses. And then the White Plains DHCR said that they didn't handle harassment, to send it down to the William Street DHCR in Manhattan. And there, they acted very crookedly, and they did not enforce the law, and they made a terrible record of negligence and dishonesty. And their names were Wallach and Stephen Cohen and Gary Friedman and Myron Holtz and Barbara Mays out in Queens. They all lied that the landlord had made a case that this was not willful, and that they had that he had provided proof, but there was no proof available. So that came out of 2 lawsuits. The first one was Coppola got, and he did such a bad job in the first one, he should have recused himself on the second one, but he didn't have the judicial requirements to do that, and he made a mess of the second one, and those cases were, his bad decisions were appealed in the appellate division, second department, but they don't know what they're doing either. And then both of them went up to the New York State Court of Appeals, and the appellate division mixed the cases up and heard the second one first and the first one second. And so the second one was ruled on first, and the New York State Court of Appeals doesn't hear. They're deaf, dumb, and blind up there. It does no good to make a motion for leave to appeal. They don't even know you exist. And you just don't do us any good, and we pay them all that money. And then the first case, which should have gone up there first, went up second because the appellate division mixed everything up and got everything backwards, they usually do. And so the first one is up there waiting for a decision for motion, on a motion for leave to appeal. And the first one is, second one is over. See, they get them all mixed up. Second one is over. So that's the travesty of justice in the state of New York. The Bible, that the very hairs of our head are numbered. And in the case of some people, every year it gets a little easier to take the inventory. And the wife entered the bank and said, I want to open two accounts. I want to open a joint account. I want a checking account for me and a deposit account for my husband. And there are three ways that men can wear their hair. Three ways men can wear their hair: parted, unparted, and departed. Colabella, Elizabeth Hubbard, Alan Beck, Michelle Maupin, the fund for modern courts, more properly called the fund for ancient courts. How did that all start? We were nice enough to volunteer for Elizabeth Hubbard to go out and monitor the courts, write these long reports, buy our own postage, do our own copying, buy our own envelopes, and send them down to New York for her, because she promised that she would, at the end of the monitoring period, write a report. So in the worst winter that we've had that you can remember, in the deepest snow and the coldest winds and the ice, we went all the way up to Pigskill and we monitored those courts for 2 weeks. And then we went to Rye and monitored the courts over there. You can't park in Rye. There's no place to park. And you get hauled into court for a parking ticket while you're monitoring courts. And then for Port Chester, we monitored. That's a terribly busy court. A lot of bad things happen over there. And then we monitored the courts in Yonkers. Six judges, six parts. Very nice courts. So we did all that work, maybe over 100 hours, maybe spent over $100. And then Elizabeth Hubbard goes back on her word. Now that's not right. She doesn't write a report on the judges. She does not distribute the information. So all of the work we did for was done for nothing. Do you think that we would have done all that work and spent all that money if Elizabeth Hubbard had said in the beginning we're not going to have a report at the end of the monitoring period? Well, Elizabeth Hubbard is just as common as any of these lawbreakers. They break the law, they break the institutions, they break the social level, they throw away their ethics. And instead of saying, I'm sorry, I did wrong, let me atone, they lie and they cover up. And they cost the courts and the poor people who are injured, who just go on getting injured more, all of this time and all of this stress, and ruin their lives. And I bring to mind again Susan, who just lost her house. So anyhow, so they taught me in high school that if you're wronged, you go to court and you will find justice. Well, as I've told you, that's a lie that they teach the kids in high school. They should stop teaching the kids that, because we don't have any courts. We just have piles of rubble. They call them courts, but they're just piles of rubble. Lives and fortunes and families and happiness pulverize into piles of rubble because of greedy, grubby, politically connected judges who are, in addition to all that, inept and unqualified. So I sued, and Judge Colabella, because I blew the whistle on his law clerks and their lack of professionalism, to get spite and malice, ruled that this case was frivolous. Well, it's anything but frivolous. And then he, Judge Colabella, one is just as bad as the other, told me to pay $4,500 attorney's fees to Edmund Purvis, who hardly qualifies even as a lawyer. He's hardly worth 2 cents an hour. and but Judge Colabella stayed the collection of that judgment until the outcome of my appeal in the appellate division. And it'll be 6 or 7 or 8 months before the appellate division calendars that for an oral argument, after which they make the decision. Very kind and very advanced and civilized Carl Ancizera, who heads up the Americans for Legal Reform with Harvey Cash. Carl punched up his LexisNexis, and he sent me this case. And I want to read you a statement about the disqualifying or the unqualified decision of Judge Colabella. It was intellectually unqualified. It was emotionally unqualified. And what is said, what this judge named Laser from the Appellate Division, Second Department, said about a frivolous lawsuit. It's very hard to read. So it's going to take, oh, see that? It's terribly hard to read. Also troubling is the fact that frivolity, like beauty, is often in the eyes of the beholder. An action or motion which may appear frivolous to one judge may, in fact, be the beginning of a new development in the law. Many causes of action and procedures which are commonplace today would at one time have been deemed frivolous. For example, prior to the swift demise of the citadel of privity and the dramatic growth of a cause of action in strict products liability, cases asserting such claims might well have been deemed frivolous. Another such example is the cause of action for negligent infliction of emotional harm, which has only recently found limited acceptance by the Court of Appeals. In a similar vein, prior to Dole versus Dow Chemical, a claim for contribution by an active tortfeasor would have been considered nonsensical. Indeed, the day is not long past when a claim that a woman was entitled to choose to have an abortion, that a couple was entitled to a certain degree of sexual privacy, or that a person had a right to attend an integrated public school would have been summarily rejected. Yet, it is as a result of the constant influx of novel claims, innovative procedures, and fresh ideas that our common law grows and flourishes. Without them, it must inevitably stultify and decay. This judge says, his name is Laser, I fear that this unbridled power, now recognized by my colleagues, cannot but discourage creative advocacy, for to assert an unfamiliar claim will be to at least risk the imposition of a sanction by a court that might be too overwhelmed by the familiar litany of complaints to distinguish between the innovated and the absurd. Nor does the availability of an appeal diminish the chilling effect of this power to sanction, for no appeal will carry its own threat of an additional sanction. After all, if the original act is indeed found to have been properly classified as frivolous or abusive, would not an appeal from that determination also be frivolous or abusive by definition? Thus, on policy grounds alone, I cannot concur in my colleague's recognition of this sanctioned power. There's a judge with a little gray matter. You don't find that very often. And this judge goes on to refute another thing that Colabella does. This judge says, Laser, even aside from these fundamental concerns, however, I must take issue with the very foundations of the majority's determination that the courts have an inherent power, quote, to require an abusive or neglectful litigant or attorney to pay a sum of money to the opposing party when such party has suffered by reason of the abusive conduct. Alternatively, the judge may direct that such payment be made directly to the court when it appears that the efficient disposition of the business before it has been impaired by reason of the conduct in question. So Colabella, there's a punishment to me of $4,500 attorney fees, which is an outrageous ripoff, greedy, grubby, consumer fraud amount. By saying that, he's saying he's punishing me because I brought a frivolous lawsuit, but as you can see, this is not a frivolous lawsuit. Elizabeth Hubbard breached contract. She went back on her word. She made an agreement with me. I kept my end of the bargain. She failed on hers. And instead of acting like a grown-up, she has to act like a kid. Well, I've got good news for you folks. Elizabeth Hubbard is out. That is a great victory. She is gone. Journal, Tuesday, July the 18th, 1995. Elizabeth V. Hubbard has resigned as the executive director for the Fund and Committee for Modern Courts, a post she held for the past 3.5 years. In a news release, she stated that her departure was, quote, to pursue other interests, unquote. That's a platitude if I ever heard one. So I hope that this was another lawbreaker who was brought to justice, not through a judge nor through a court, but through you people, through letting the public know. Carl Ancestera sent me this other case, which is the case of Betty Muka, plaintiff, versus the New York State Bar Association. And the decision on this case, the man who made it, Zeller, was disqualified from making it. He's obviously prejudiced and biased from the beginning because he belongs to the American Bar Association, excuse me, the New York State Bar Association. So this is so crooked. And this happened up in Tompkins County, which is where Ithaca, New York is, in the Supreme Court of New York. And it happened way back in 1983. And I think that this woman got triple shafted. And this decision by Zeller is as bad as the decisions we get from the Westchester Supreme Court. So I'm beginning to think that the Supreme Court of the state of New York, no matter what county, is as bad as the Westchester Supreme Court. And so they say that he has to, I have been a defendant in prior lawsuits brought by Mrs. Muka. I am named, this is a judge talking, and they're having this judge decide this case, and he's been a defendant in previous lawsuits. I am named as a conspirator in this action, and I am a member of the New York State Bar Association. Under normal circumstances, I would recuse myself. Well, I would think so, Mr. Zeller. But the circumstances here are unusual. Mrs. Muka has either sued or accused of crime all Supreme Court justices of the 6th Judicial District, one of whom she once took into custody by means of a citizen's arrest. Hooray! Since 1982, Mrs. Muka has had pending an action in which the named defendants are the Supreme Court of the state of New York and its judges, law clerks, employees and staff or officials, and as private individuals, all justices of this judicial district and probably elsewhere in the state are members of the New York State Bar Association. And so this judge, Zeller, find out that you aren't going to find out? And so naturally, he dismisses her case as frivolous. What does he know about frivolity? What does he know about justice? So we will be getting a letter out to Zeller. And by the way, I tracked Zeller down. And he has left the Tompkins County Supreme Court, 6th Judicial District. And he has gone to Oneida. And guess what? Judicial hearing officer. Old crooked judges never die. They just fade away into being judicial hearing officers, continuing to milk the state, continuing with their disqualification and their ineptitude. So we will be writing out a complaint to him and send it up to him in Oneida. Matter of the Attorney General of the State of New York and their wicked assistant attorney generals, who are just about as dishonest as anybody can be, and yet they call themselves the Department of Law of the State of New York. We have the case of Charles B. Sanders. He was already informed that Glendora sent the New York State Court of Appeals a copy of his worthless brief, respondent's brief, and yet his only reply to Glendora's filing a notice of motion for leave to appeal the rotten decision of the Appellate Division, Second Department, to the New York State Court of Appeals, the only action he takes is to send them a brief, the same brief that Glendora's already sent him. Save the trees and save the taxes for storing these papers, the real estate taxes. But he did that same dumb thing on the first Coppola bad decision, which they mixed up as Coppola 2, and he did it on Coppola 1. New York State Attorney General's office. The worst work comes out of that office. But in all these fights for rights, folks, you can find happiness because you do stand up for right and you do live cleanly. Two things kept him from being a professional athlete. He said when he played baseball, he could never hit a curved ball. Yet when he played golf, he never could hit anything else. And Bob said that he and Harold are not playing Major League Baseball because of sinus problems. Actually, he said they couldn't get anybody to sign us. And the newspaper reporter said to the little old lady, "Have you lived in Westchester all your life?" And she said, "Not yet." And you know how Harry made his waterbed more comfortable? He put water softener in it. The noise you hear is Caesar. I love it when Caesar is here because he makes everything work so well and he repairs everything so well and he's so smart. He comes from Peru and he's making a door now, shaving a door so that it'll open and close. Now let's see. Last time we talked to you about law would be on July the 13th. So, we will just let you know that this log went out. And we told you how Judge Ingrassia got afraid to be videotaped, so instead of having an oral argument on my motion to vacate his bad decision, he copped out and said that the decision would be decided on paper. This is from the Supreme Court of the State of New York, Appellate Division, Second Department. Goes way back to July 6, 1995, when this notice of appeal was filed. Long time ago. Let's see, Wood's bad decision came out. And Gracia's bad decision came out May 31st. Wood's things kept professionally. He said when he played baseball, he could never hit a curved ball. Yet when he played golf, he never could hit anything else. And Bob said that he and Harold are not playing Major League Baseball because of sinus problems. Actually, they couldn't get any, he said they couldn't get anybody to sign us. And the newspaper reporter said to the little old lady, "Have you lived in Westchester all your life?" And she said, "Not yet." And you know how Harry made his waterbed more comfortable? He put water softener in it. The noise you hear is Caesar. I love it when Caesar is here because he makes everything work so well and he repairs everything so well and he's so smart. He comes from Peru and he's making a door now, shaving a door so that it'll open and close. Now let's see, last time we talked to you about wall would be on July the 13th. So we will just let you know that this log went out and we told you how Judge Ingrassia got afraid to be videotaped, so instead of having an oral argument on my motion to vacate his bad decision, he copped out and said that the decision would be decided on paper. This is from the Supreme Court of the State of New York, Appellate Division, Second Department. Goes way back to July 6, 1995, when this notice of appeal was filed. Long time ago. Let's see, Wood's bad decision came out. And Gracia's bad decision came out May 31st. Wood's bad decision came out on June something, April, May. No, on May something. And then it was appealed. Anyway, it says Glendora, Box 416, White Plains, New York, 10602. A file has been opened in the case of title Glendora versus Walsh. The court is Supreme County, Westchester, paper order, dated May the 31st, 1995, index number 2048293. This case has been assigned the following number on the docket of this court, 1995-0635. That would have only cost $50 for a notice of appeal and $250 for a writing request for appellate division intervention, but the Westchester Supreme Court and all of its bungling had divided into two cases. It's already cost $50 for a note of issue. And so now it's going to cost $600 instead of $300. That's the wisdom of the great and wonderful judges of the Westchester Supreme Court. I sent $10 to the New York State Tenants Association. I wish you would. We thank you for your generous contribution. With your support, we will continue our efforts to preserve and improve tenants' rights and affordable housing. Your generous contribution makes our work possible. Your active participation will make winning possible in the face of the escalating threat to tenant protections. Thank you for standing up with us. Sincerely, Michael McKee, Director of Development and Communications, President, and everything else. These are the stats on wall. 7.5 hours work. $6.24 money. Number of tortious acts of Walsh, Alpucci, and Larkin is 2,740. Page number is 3,192, a bad record. And the number of mailings is 170. And now we look at the week of July the 17th, 1995. This is mailing number 171, exhibit number Moo the Third. Page number 3,193, number of tortious acts is 2,740. Nella blew her horn three times under Glendora's south bedroom window at 5:32 p.m. Monday, July 17th. She has no right even to drive into the area between buildings A and D. She has no parking space here. I met Eric Fisher, officer on the streets of White Plains, and he asked how things were going up here, and I told him that they were much better. that these people have finally learned that there is a law and that they have to live by it. And that I told him that when there was a burst of outbreaks of law breaking a couple of months ago, I was overwhelmed with a rash of things to do and never could call him. We talked about Judge Wood and Judge Ingracia, about the appellate division, about the new lawsuit that's coming up. And he has read the logs. I don't know how they come in there. The log is sent to Commission Dolce. We had to cut down on the number of people we sent it to because of the printing costs and the postage costs are getting outrageous. So it goes to Commissioner Dolce, and then I guess it goes to James Bradley, and then I guess it goes to Captain Quinn, and then to Lieutenant Rossi, and then down to Eric Fisher. Harold, when are you thinking of getting married? Susan.
Constantly.
Did get out when it should have. That was on Monday. It went out to 14 people. It now goes to the DHCR. Franklin went down and saw the DHCR and handed him in a copy of our check of $28 every month we have to pay for the furnace. How the DHCR is going to handle this, they're going to deal with the reduction in rent due to decrease in services with the heat and the hot water. Failing us 16 times and all of the trouble it causes us, all of the stress and all of the work with people coming and going in here. And what else? They're going to handle that first. And then the leak, the water, they're going to handle. And then other lack of repairs, I guess. And that's too bad because Caesar's right here doing repairs now. And then the harassment part they're going to handle later. Franklin went in to ask the examiner, Mr. Morgan, if he could come and look at the videotapes. And Mr. Morgan says, well, we'll wait until we do the harassment part and then we'll have a hearing. Then that'll be the time to show the videotapes. Okay. Michael Koza has lied again and again. There's two of them. Where was Caesar? He had borrowed the magic marker and the scrap paper and the scotch tape. They put a sign on the bicycle telling the people that if they don't take it by Saturday, it'll be gone. He'd already put a sign on there yesterday, two signs, and they're both of the signs are gone, but the bicycle's still there. It's amazing how crooked people can be. Should not be in the cellar, it's in a common area. So, anyway, I forgot where I was telling you about the DHCR. And at 2:30 p.m., Nella stole parking space 2B, and Caesar was here with a new helper named Leslie, and they swept out the puddles from the cellar. The inspector from the DHCR was going to come and see them, and I think that the code enforcement officer from the White Plains Building Department came to see them. And Peter said, how much does it cost to get married? And the city clerk says $30 for the license and one paycheck every week the rest of your life. Oh, I know what I was telling you. Koza lying again. Koza says he doesn't owe the $30 and he makes up some dumb excuse why he doesn't. So he also at the same time shows that he doesn't know the law. You and I know that he owes $15 for each of those depositions. Because when I was, you remember with the Michael Gelman case? And I was called in and I got the $15 for each of those for going down there as a witness, even though I'm the party, even though I'm the plaintiff, and also the $15 for the subpoena deuces tecum. So Michael Gelman again shows that he doesn't know the law and again shows how crooked he is. then when he sends in the judgment, and of course Judge Wood signed the judgment. Of course he would, because Judge Wood is greedy, graspy, and grubby for that judicial hearing officer appointment. And Wilson Bay, Koza Cousins, Convoy are politically connected, and they're pulling the strings on that. So naturally, Judge Wood does everything that Wilson Babe asks him to do. Now, I could do one of two things. I could make an order to Judge Wood and ask him to sign it for that $30, but Judge Wood doesn't have his own mind. He's controlled by Wilson Babe, and so he probably wouldn't sign it against them because he doesn't have anything to do with justice, even though that's his name, Justice. Or I could take Michael Kozer to the small claims court in Yonkers. It's a good lawsuit, but we have bad courts. The lawsuit is good, the court's bad, so you can't go into court. You have no recourse at all. You know, this great, wonderful United States justice system and all that is supposed to get justice. Well, there isn't any justice. We don't have any courts. We don't have any good judges. Trumpets and blow the trumpets. Here is the new lawsuit. Walsh, Alpucci, Larkin. This is the new one. And this is the file. The file's pretty much in order. And here are the defendants. The first one is Harold Wood. The second one is Angelo and Gracia. The third one is Paul Carlucci. The law firm of Wilson Babe et al., 2 William Street, White Plains, New York, 10601. Kevin Convoy, Michael Koza, John Cousins, Leo McGrath, Kevin O'Dell, Alexander Karamitsos, Walter Farnham, the CEO of General Accident Insurance Company. That's Larkin's Insurance Company. Bruce Bendage, 399 Knollwood Road, White Plains, New York. Andrew Larkin, Harrison, New York police officer. Kevin Larkin, his son. Nella Alpucci, tenant in apartment 4B, 21 Greenridge Avenue, White Plains, New York, 10605. Theo Alpucci, her son. Daniel Walsh, tenant in apartment 3A, 21 Greenridge Avenue, White Plains, New York, 10605. Roberta Walsh, his wife. James Walsh, their son. John Porzio, owner of 21 Greenridge Avenue, White Plains, New York, 10605. Westchester Supreme Court, 111 Grove Street, White Plains, New York, 10601. The Appellate Division, 2nd Department, New York Supreme Court, 45 Monroe Place, Brooklyn, New York, 11201. New York State Court of Appeals, 20 Eagle Street, Albany, New York, 12207. Now, I am trying to make a decision whether to add these people. You tell me what you think. Should I add Gordon Burroughs, Nikolai, Ruskin, Donovan, Garayan, Rosado, Fredman, Coppola, Coppola? I add those as defendants? On what grounds? Okay, let's go on. This is page one. You are going to be sued, as I said you were going to be sued. You are going to be sued for violating the 14th Amendment of the United States, which prohibits a state from denying Glendora equal protection of the laws. You will be sued in the United States District Court, Southern District of New York, pursuant to Title 42 of the United States. The United States Code, Section 1983, this says that Glendora has certain rights given her by the Constitution of the United States and by Congress, and if you violate these rights, you are liable to Glendora. Do you understand this so far? Moving on, let us look at Federal Rules of Civil Procedure, Rule 27. This says that discovery can start before the action begins. Take a look at this rule. Glendora is conducting this discovery for a sole purpose, to find out the truth, to find out the truth of everything that happened between each and every one of you. Intense examination will be ongoing until every last piece of this puzzle is joined and the whole picture can be seen at once. The discovery will be ongoing until the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth is exposed. This will probably take years and years. Then judge and jury can see it all, so get ready. It is coming soon. Depositions and oral questioning, written interrogatories, documents, admission, inspection on the premises. Then there is a lawsuit in the White Plains City Court and a third lawsuit in Yonkers City Court. You are not going to violate my right to equal protection of the law and get away with it. And there are the First Amendment, Second Amendment, and the 14th Amendment. All persons born or naturalized in the United States and subject to the jurisdiction thereof are citizens of the United States and of the state wherein they reside. No state shall make or enforce any law which shall abridge the privileges or immunities of citizens of the United States, nor shall any state deprive any person of life, liberty, or property without due process of law, nor deny to any person within its jurisdiction the equal protection of the law. You go back and look at those decisions. Did I receive equal protection of the law? Was I deprived of life, liberty, or property? Certainly property. And here's the civil rights rule that I've read to you so many times, and which I stated in this lawsuit. And the district court shall have original jurisdiction of all civil actions arising under the Constitution, laws, or treaties of the United States. Civil rights and elective franchise. The district court shall have original jurisdiction of any civil action authorized by law to be commenced by any person to recover damages for injury to his person or property or because of the deprivation of any right or privilege of a citizen of the United States by any act done in furtherance of any conspiracy mentioned in Section 1985 of Title 42. And this is Title 42. And that's as far as it got. And I think that's just over. If you give me a decision whether I should include these people, I think I should, don't you? And that brings you up to date on the law breaking of Walsh, Alpucci, Larkin, and of their lawyers, Bendish, Wilson, Babe, Karamitsos, McGrath, Odell, Koza, Conboy, Cousins, and of the judges, Wood and Ingracia, and of their law clerk, well, at least of the law clerk, Paul Carlucci. The lawsuit is good, but the courts are bad. Folks, we have to start off with a few jokes here before we tell you about the law-breaking of Michael Gelman, producer of Live with Regis. The problem that the National Hockey Association is having, the playoffs are conflicting with their openers, and Dorothy says, I finally wrote something that a publisher accepted. It's my check for the Book of the Month Club. And did you ever hear what the publisher said to Tolstoy, to Leo Tolstoy? What did the publisher say to Leo Tolstoy? Look, Leo, either you write a book about war or about peace. And an Eskimo and an eagle, an Eskimo sitting in an igloo with his little son was reading him nursery rhymes, and the daddy read, little Jack Horner sat in a corner with, and the little boy says, Daddy, what's a corner? We're going to report to you on Michael Gelman, who did not have the ethics to return Glendora's property to VHS videotapes. Way back in 1989, 90, 91. And I sued him in court for that as a breach of contract, and Judge Sarah Lee Evans made the wrong decision and said it wasn't a breach of contract. So the next time I sue Michael Gelman, it will be for return of chattel. because nobody can say that he didn't do that. He has said so himself that he didn't return them. And then maybe the next judge will hear the evidence, the audio tapes, and look at the log. And you can't get a hold of the appeals clerk. The line is always busy. But we did receive the green card that my corrections of the minutes, which I paid $400 for, my correction of the minutes did go out, was received, along with the notice of settlement of those minutes. And you can't ever find anything out about from Michael Gelman. He's autistic. He won't come to the phone. He won't answer letters. And so you don't know whether he complied and did what the law told him to do, settle the minutes by July 3rd. I certainly haven't heard from him. And you can't get a hold of the small claims clerk in Manhattan. On one line, it's a recorder, and on the other line, it just nobody ever picks up. So it's really something. So what do we do about that? I don't know. But as soon as those minutes are settled, they go across the street to the appellate term, and then I have 60 days to write my appellant's brief. And I certainly know what I'm going to say in that. That lawsuit was brought September 20th, 1994 for $380, and it still isn't resolved. It shows you what bad shape the judges and the courts are in, and that we don't have any courts. Announcements, Americans for Legal Reform, help reform our legal system. This is headed up by Carl Ancicera and Harvey Cash, and their number is 777. This is area code 516, Nassau County, Suffolk County, 777-7307. 777-7307. So if you have a problem with a lawyer, call them. Also, I join the Center for Judicial Accountability. And that number is White Plains, 914-421-1200. These are some of the petitions that I've gone out and got 11 signatures on each page. It's always a problem how to show these things to you on camera. They don't flip the way they should. And I've done about 7 or 8 pages of these. And what is the petition? It's we the people hereby petition Governor George Pataki to join a state commission, to appoint a state commission to investigate and hold public hearings on judicial corruption and the political manipulation of judgeships in the state of New York. It's about time. You want to sign that petition? Nice to be getting one's life back. On Friday, July 7th, I was able to do 180 telephone calls. Franklin took 4 programs to Yonkers. Yonkers has a new system. You want to sign that petition? Nice to be getting one's life back. On Friday, July 7th, I was able to do 180 telephone calls. Franklin took four programs to Yonkers. Yonkers has a new system in being constructed. It's called the Optimum System. Channels go up to 77, and a chat with Glendora is on channel 77 at 11 p.m. every Thursday night in Yonkers. On the old system, it's on channel 37 at 4 p.m. every Thursday. So, we wish to commend Janine at Yonkers for doing such a wonderful job on the coverage of the rally June the 19th and having it on their TV news. It was really good. The Alliance for Community Media has got a stay pending the outcome of their appeal to the United States Supreme Court. Of LTV went out. Center for the what's it called? Media Alliance, Alliance for Media. And she went to it in Boston, and so did Fraser Doherty. And it's fun to call up LTV at 2:30 p.m. every Tuesday and listen to channel 37, and they put you on hold, and coming through the phone is your program. You can hear your program, so that's nice. My second Smith Corona typewriter all of a sudden would not, there's something in the plug, the electric plug, and it wouldn't connect, make the connection. So we took it down to Office Max, and Tom Hyatt exchanged it for a new one, because we only bought it on around the 1st of April, April Fool's Day. I was done the work at 7:18 p.m. on Tuesday. It's nice to have your life back again and have free time. The church in the Highlands redecorated the manse, and it's just beautiful. The floors, the walls, the window casements, the windows, it's just beautiful. Monday, I was able to make 160 calls. You want to sign that petition? Nice to be getting one's life back. On Friday, July 7th, I was able to do 180 telephone calls. Franklin took four programs to Yonkers. Yonkers has a new system in being constructed. It's called the Optimum System. Channels go up to 77, and a chat with Glendora is on channel 77 at 11 p.m. every Thursday night in Yonkers. On the old system, it's on channel 37 at 4 p.m. every Thursday. So, we wish to commend Janine at Yonkers for doing such a wonderful job on the coverage of the rally June the 19th and having it on their TV news. It was really good. The Alliance for Community Media has got a stay pending the outcome of their appeal to the United States Supreme Court. Mary of LTV went out to the convention, the Congress of the Center for the what's it called? Media Alliance, Alliance for Media, and she went to it in Boston, and so did Fraser Doherty. And it's fun to call up LTV at 2:30 p.m. every Tuesday and listen to channel 37, and they put you on hold, and coming through the phone is your program. You can hear your program, so that's nice. My second Smith Corona typewriter all of a sudden would not, there was something in the plug, the electric plug, and it wouldn't connect, make the connection. So we took it down to Office Max, and Tom Hyatt exchanged it for a new one, because we only bought it on around the 1st of April, April Fool's Day. I was done the work at 7:18 p.m. on Tuesday. It's nice to have your life back again and have free time. The church in the Highlands redecorated the manse, and it's just beautiful. The floors, the walls, the window casements, the windows, it's just beautiful. Monday, I was able to make 160 calls, and at the library, Pace Law Library helps me somewhat following their system of SUDOCs. That's printings, publications by the Superintendent of Documents of the United States, and Pace is a government depository, so you can go in there and you can read what volumes and what papers the government has deposited at Pace University for the public to read. I say, still say down with Ottinger and down with Triffin for closing out the public. It isn't fair, it isn't reasonable. Friday the 14th, I was able to do 120 telephone calls and get the work up to date. The work has been up to date 7 days in July, and that hasn't happened for a long time. Do you like the tree? Oh, the tree is so pretty. And it's the little baby tree that fell off, and I put it in water for a long time until it finally rooted, is taking hold, and the little baby tree is coming up. And then the rest of the tree is filling itself out all the way from the bottom to the top. This is a poor tree that was thrown out into the field to die, and I rescued it. The pot was there and a little bit of soil, but I had to buy more soil, and as I say, plant soil is not dirt cheap. It was 95 degrees and humid, and one day it was 102 degrees, you remember that? And I don't think I've ever experienced 102 degrees before. And on Friday we finished the work at 8:57 p.m. and now we have 5 raccoons instead of 1 raccoon. And we feed the raccoons every night. The work was done for the 5th time in July, on July 15th at 5:29 p.m., actual free time. Sunday we worked at Pace Law Library for 2 hours. From 2:20 to 4:50 p.m. we looked at a condo across the street. They want $179,000 for it. It is lovely, but frankly, there's only windows on like the west side. Here, there's windows to the east, windows to the south, and windows to the west. So that is very important, to have windows and sunshine. The work was done at 4:10 p.m. on one day, and we had rally number 4 on July 17th, and rally number 5 is on July the 24th. And the rally dates in August are the 7th, which is a Tuesday, the 15th, which is a Wednesday, the 23rd, which is a Thursday, maybe, and the, let's see, 23 and 7 is, and I guess that's it. There's 4 in the first Monday, the second Tuesday, the third Wednesday, and the fourth Friday, Thursday or the fourth Friday. And we have other announcements for you. Copying things at Pace, it costs $4.50. The United States Supreme Court's reports are so interesting and so well done. You ought to go over there and see them. And they'll tell you that you're not allowed in the library, but you just tell them that they are a government depository and you are allowed to see government depositories. And also the code of federal regulations. See that. And also the United States statutes at large. But this is all the work it has been. But it's really fascinating to go over there and read these things. This is the list of categories of the SUDOCs, the Government Printing Office, or the Government Documents Office, Smithsonian Institution, Treasury Department, Library of Congress, Motion Picture Broadcasting and Recording. That would be interesting, wouldn't it? Science and Technology Division, Smithsonian Institution. There's two of them. Executive Office for the United States Attorneys, those are the ones who handle the lousy bankruptcy trustees. And then in the front of this book, this is put together by Anne, is a list of the categories, and that tells you if PACE has those depositories. See, they don't take everything that the United States government offers. So I have to go back to high school days and college days where you didn't have copying machines, where you learned to take notes and learn from notes, not learn from copies of everything. Oh, yes, about Coca-Cola. Okay, this is the telephone number for Coca-Cola, and the people there are very rude and very abrupt. And I should think after you call them that you would be interested in drinking only Pepsi, never Coca-Cola again. But the name of the president is Roberto C. Goldsueta, G-O-L-Z-U-E-T-A, Goldsueta. He's the chairman and the CEO. And for years I've been calling down there since 1989, as a matter of fact, and trying to get through to Mr. Goldsueta. And the people are so rude and so evasive and so devious. So I'd like to have you call their number. It's 404, that's Atlanta, 676-676-2121. And that's the switchboard, and you watch out how rude they are to you. But finally, after 6 years, came a breakthrough. I got Mr. Goldsueta's direct dial number. I'd like to see you fool around with the 2121 number and see how exasperated you get. But I'll give you the direct dial number, 2263. 2263 is the direct dial number. And a woman will answer Mr. Goldsueta's office. And that took 6 years to get that number. Suit of 1995 is Doris Sassauer versus the Commission on Judicial Conduct, public interest lawsuit of great value to you, because here in New York State, one reason we have so many lousy judges is that the Commission on Judicial Conduct doesn't do its job. It's politically motivated like all the judges, and Gerald Stern and his gang do not do the job. And so she sued them, and I joined in as an intervener. Seven other ones joined in as an intervener. And this crazy assistant attorney general representing the Commission on Judicial Conduct sent out the most vapid letter you could imagine. And I answered that. Here it is, Amy Abramovitz. It's the silliest piece. Team Express Mail, look at it. Now that's the kind of work, the caliber of work you get out of the Attorney General's Office of the State of New York. We've been through some, like, what's his name? The last one, he was terrible. It is so childish, the work that comes. Anyway, this is the Supreme Court of the County of New York, or the Supreme Court of the State of New York, New York County. Doris L. Sassauer, petitioner. Glendora intervener against the Commission on Judicial Conduct of the State of New York. The index number is 95109141. They've had 109,000 cases in the New York County Supreme Court. Reply affidavit of intervener Glendora in opposition to Abramovitz, opposition to interveners. Glendora, being duly sworn, deposes and says her reasons follow for opposing the affirmation of Amy L. Abramovitz in opposition to the interveners. Abramovitz of affirmation in opposition to interveners is totally without merit. It is a piece of gossamer and is vapid. Sassauer's case is one of the 10 most significant cases to come to the New York Supreme Court in 1995. Our lives have been ruined by bad judges in the New York Supreme Court. That the Commission on Judicial Conduct should have cleaned out years ago. A trivial argument of delay, quote unquote, can hardly stand up to this gargantuan evil, noted supra in paragraph 2. Under such circumstances, quote unquote, intervention is particularly appropriate. Abramovitz is wasting our taxpayer money sending out her affirmation by express mail for $10.75, and this is on a Friday afternoon when the express mail cannot be picked up until Monday anyhow. She should get her act together. Glendora is pleased to find out she is such a featherweight. This paper by Abramovitz is anemic further. In that, it is only an attorney's affirmation. An affidavit notarized would have been more convincing to Glendora. Because we have so many bad judges that the Commission on Judicial Conduct has failed to remove, we are rallying tomorrow, July 12th, in front of the Westchester Supreme Court, our third rally against bad judges. Number four will be July 17th, and number five will be July 24th. Come, if you can. Glendora opposes Abramovitz's request for an additional 15 days to submit an answer. She's already had her opportunity to submit an answer and she squandered it. Dated White Plains, New York, July 11, 1995. Yours in truth, Glendora. Chat with Glendora, Box 416, White Plains, 914-949-9495. And it's notarized by Ivan Pinario. And here's one of our blank petitions. We the people hereby petition Governor George Pataki to appoint a state commission to investigate and hold public hearings on judicial corruption and the political manipulation of judgeships in the state of New York. One of the interveners is Jean Krasinski, which in this assistant attorney general called him George in the caption, and Norman Safestine. Our First Amendment rights last night in the Westchester Pavilion, and we were accosted by burly, uncouth, self-important, overweight, so-called security guard. His name is Tom Sims. He works for Complete Security Corporation or Complete Security Company or whatever. And he like has a fake badge and fake badges here and a fake metal badge, you know, walking around pompously. And so I have declared that I will not go shopping at the Westchester Pavilion until that man is fired. Consumer ripoff, the White Plains, the greedy White Plains Parking Authority. So Mayor Cy Shulman can get a raise, I guess. If you park, you put your money in your meter and it's overtime, and they used to have a very good system, and then you just go and pay for the overtime, but now they couldn't stand to resist the money. And so if you parked overtime over 3 hours, instead of paying for that 3 hours, they make you pay $10. And now that's one ripoff. The other ripoff is that in the White Plains Parking Authority office, in the library garage, they don't have those rates posted so that a person doesn't know that, a consumer doesn't know that. And as soon as I can, I'm getting in touch with the head of the White Plains Parking Authority and telling them that's a fraud. If you park, let's see, if you park over an hour, it's $1. If you park over 2 hours, I guess it's $2. No, I guess it's $5 or something. And then if you park between 2 hours and 3 hours over, I guess that's $5. And between two and three, that's $3. And then if you park over three, that's $10. If I had known that, I wouldn't have done that. I was going on the assumption that it was the way it always had been. It should pay just for the overtime. Grubby greed everywhere. So board has failed to find me the hymns, you know, the hymns that you've listened to for years. You've listened to them so long that the poor cassette is worn out. And well, it isn't really. I can play it on my little stereo cassette player and it works fine, but over at TCI, that great big one that flips the sides over and plays the other side and all that fancy thing, that it jams and it's crinkled my nice hymns. So I had to go out and look for a new one, and the name of these is Hymns Triumphant, and it's by the London Philharmonic and the London the National Symphony Chorus. And you know, they're unbeatable, they're unmatchable, they're unapproachable. So I wanted that one naturally again, and Borders failed to get it, and so you go out on your own. On yourself you can rely. So you go out on your own, and I found through library information the name of the manufacturer, and I called them up. They're in Tennessee, and they're going to, they had me try a store down in Manhattan, but those people didn't know what they're doing, and acted dumb. And I, when the woman called me from Tennessee, I dialed that number that she gave me because I had a suspicion that this was the way it was going to turn out. And so I dialed the number, and so the woman from Tennessee could hear the people in Manhattan acting dumb. And so she could see what the problem was, and she says, okay, I'll send you one. So we'll have our hymns back maybe. They haven't come yet, though. In the meantime, I have other hymns for you by the Mormon Tabernacle Choir. In the orchestra in back of that is Eugene Ormandy, Philadelphia Orchestra, and you just can't beat that. And I root for the Phillies. Those are the Phillies I root for, the Philadelphia Orchestra, Symphony Orchestra. And so that might be the hymns you're hearing in the background now, and I got other ones by the choir of the Mormon Tabernacle. Those hymns are beautiful. People love the music on the show. They don't necessarily like the show, but they do like the music. Okay, what else do we have to tell you about? I think we're all up to date. All the big news, I think, is here. It's quite a job to keep a list for you. I wanted to just add that what Gelman has cost me was his irresponsibility and lack of ethics, and his lack of upbringing, and his lack of religious education, and morals, and the Ten Commandments, and everything else has cost me. It has cost me about $560. It has cost me 760 hours of my life, just because he doesn't have the ethics to return a person's property. So you have to stand up to people like that. You have to teach them a lesson, even though it costs you more to learn to teach them a lesson. You have to stand up for your rights, and you have to fight for right, and you have to fight evil. And also, a church should allow freedom of speech, don't you think? Okay, this is Chat with Glendora, and this is what has happened from July the 13th, 1995, up through today, which is July the 19th, 1995, Wednesday. I ought to tell you some jokes. We'll close with three jokes, and then I'll help you keep your courage flaming. The boss said to Jennifer, I don't know how we could get along without you around here. And Jennifer says, that's good. And the boss says, but tomorrow we're going to start trying. And Sydney's company is one big happy family, and that's because he hires all of his relatives. And the boss went around to all of the employees saying, this is my son Richard. He's going to start at the bottom for a few days. And some bosses, Peter used to have a boss who said, uh-uh, don't agree with me. It's too late. I've already changed my mind. And here's the recommendation one employer gave a former employee. Bob Johnson worked for us for 10 years, and when he left, we were very satisfied. And in business circles, Ted is called a Renaissance man. That's because all of his ideas come from the 15th century. You take care, folks, and keep your courage flaming. Bye-bye. God bless you.
In Portchester, Stacy Sweet, News 12.
A group of Westchester residents held a protest in front of the Westchester County Courthouse today. They're rallying for legal reform. Members of the Center for Judicial Accountability participated this afternoon in White Plains. The demonstration, they say, is in response to concern about lapses in some judges meeting the standard code of conduct. The ralliers say the law is sometimes not administered fairly.
People come into court, they see all sorts of abusive conduct by judges who yell, scream, who are vicious to them, run over their rights, say that the Constitution doesn't matter to them.
Mothers are losing their children. People are being put out on the street. Homes are being lost. Why? Only if the judges just do their jobs.
The Center for Judicial Accountability was formed in 1989. A new law may soon be on the books to help Rytown senior citizens.
Message 9, 10, 13 p.m., Friday, July 21. Thank you.